you think this has a happy ending, you haven't been paying attention.
Welcome back to the Throne of the Dragon podcast, the show that covers each and every episode of HBO's House of the Dragon. I'm Josh.
And I'm Curtis.
And we are back for season one, episode three. Give me just a second. I keep wanting to say the Rogue Prince.
He's right behind you. Something about his second name. I can't remember.
How second of his name.
Second of his name. There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is just in reference to baby Aegon.
Baby.
So they do that with, I'm pretty sure they do it by, like, now I'm like questioning it. I can't remember if they do it by the second in your family line named that, or if you are the second born child of that family. Yeah, I can't ever remember. I'm pretty sure it's like done by like the first Aegon was the conqueror,
right?
And then yeah, this is Aegon too. I don't think there's been another Aegon in between the two of them. I don't think.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, the title of the episode is just in reference to baby Aegon, who's going to be a big part of this. I'm like 99% sure I misspoke before, and that the whole rivalry basically between Rhaenyra and Daemon is not what really matters in like 20 years from now. I'm pretty sure that it's going to be between Rhaenyra's line and Alicent's line.
Yeah.
So the firstborn son and the firstborn daughter, or the firstborn son of the firstborn daughter. So
maybe it's just like right now, or in like season one, it's more of between Daemon and Rhaenyra.
Yeah.
And then like gets to the second season, you know, you start kind of building on something else or whatever.
Yeah. But I feel like the episode started pretty strong. Do you think that was a pretty cool intro scene?
It was a good intro scene. I will say though, with the whole Battle of the Stepstones at the very end, I was kind of disappointed.
Were you?
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I just felt like there was going to be more to it, and I don't know. I was just kind of like, ugh. I don't know.
Well, once we kind of
get
around,
get me wrong. It was good. I just felt like there should have been more to it, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I'll explain kind of like the the region, like the Stepstones, how fighting typically goes there, like how the just history has shown.
Yeah.
And I think it'll make a little bit more sense to you. It was how I kind of justified it, I feel like.
Okay.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty cool because this is the first time in House of the Dragon that we see dragons like in the fighting.
Right.
So yeah, this opening scene, Crabfeeder just doing more of the same, which we find out that his name is Prince Draemon.
Yeah.
And I do wonder, because I don't really know a whole lot about him, but I wondered if he got burned. Like
dragon?
Originally, well, like if he got burned in the fight at some point, like if he got burned when they first started going against the Valyrians,
maybe
because Laenor's out there, so like even if Daemon wasn't involved yet, you know,
yeah,
or if that happened earlier, but there's like so few dragons in the world that like it wouldn't have just happened to him somewhere else.
Right.
So, I don't know. We might could look into that, but it also just doesn't really seem like it matters because he's dead. So
he didn't even get like one line. not even a hello or anything.
Yeah.
Which is kind of weird to me.
Well, I don't know. I think that's just part of the character that they tried to build up, like that he's more of a monster than like a man, you know?
And I know, like, at the same time too, is like he's not a huge part to the story. I mean, he plays in to Daemon's story, obviously, as we're going to see in the next episode and beyond, because of what he did to him at the very end and kind of showing his strength in the Stepstones now by defeating him by himself, basically, you know? Yeah. So obviously it's not like he was a big part of the story, but he was a little bump in the road there.
He's kind of just a device in,
right,
there, like you were saying, like telling Daemon's story and building his reputation.
Exactly.
So, but the Crabfeeder's men are just slaughtering House Velaryon's men. And then Daemon comes in and just starts roasting everybody. And did you see kind of what I was talking about, like in this scene, about how, like, it's not just like people get burned and it's like, oh my God, I burned to death. It's like there's people just disintegrating, like, yes, all over the place. Like the one I noticed on the rewatch that I thought was the coolest was there's a guy running and he's like right up next to the screen and he runs like off to the left of the screen. And as he's running, he gets burned. And then all you see is like a leg fall down.
Yeah.
And there's like nothing left.
That's a shame.
Yeah. And that's a big, I don't know, it's a big part of like the fear factor of House Targaryen. You know, if you go into a battle and you're seeing guys get cut down with swords and axes and all this stuff, yeah, it's super brutal and traumatic. Like, you know, we see at the end of the fight where guys are just like hacking through each other.
Right. Yeah.
Which it reminded me of a scene I want to send you from the last season of Game of Thrones, where I think the episode's The Bells, and all the guards go to like lay down their arms basically when Dany attacks the city with their dragon, and all of her soldiers are just like standing there like kind of in a standoff with them, like tensions are super high, and then all of a sudden like her foot soldiers just start like massacring these like unarmed men. And so it's just a slaughter, like just hacking through people.
My favorite part of the intro to this episode is the guy that's the soldier for the House of Valerian. Prince, what is his name, Draen?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's like, you're going to get killed, blah, blah, blah. And he's like, no. And he gets his hand crucified into that wood. And then, of course, the crab's on him. But that's not even the funniest part to me, is the part when Daemon starts riding. He's like, oh, my prince, come save me. The foot right on top of him.
Yeah.
Which, you know, in a way, he kind of did save him. He probably put him out of his misery.
Yeah. I thought it was pretty funny.
Yeah, that's a little comedic relief there.
Yeah. I don't know. I didn't like the actor, though. He reminded me too much of Euron Greyjoy from Game of Thrones. Like, just in like his shit talking and everything. Like, I don't know. He reminded me too much of Euron Greyjoy.
We find out there's a strategic move, though, that they keep doing, that every time either they bring the dragons in or they bring more soldiers in, they just keep running into the caves and hiding, which is, they're small caves. They're not huge or anything. So they're basically little rat tunnels.
Yeah.
So it's like if you go in after them, you're just going to be slaughtered by them.
Yeah.
So we kind of find that out in this scene.
Yeah. And they run, which comes all into
play
over
later on.
Yeah. And they run all over this island. And so, yeah, like you were saying, what they do is they'll attack and then withdraw back into the caves. And when they do, that's when the archers come out and just start raining on the valley there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's the Triarchy strategy. And that's kind of what makes this whole thing more viable, like in my mind, you know. Yeah, it's a small stretch of land. They have dragons, they have the ships, they have all this stuff, but the Triarchy does have a steady supply of men coming in, and right. they've got the caves, you know, they've got an advantage here. They can just pop out few at a time and slaughter guys and then just move back into the caves. So the dragons aren't really very useful against them.
Right.
And I believe they just got the two dragons out there. Daemon and then Laenor Velaryon.
Oh, he's got a dragon?
Yeah. Do you not realize that was him flying around on the dragon in his armor and white hair?
I assume that was Daemon. I wondered why he sounded funny.
I'm like, how could it have been Daemon? He was on the ground, like in the middle of the fight.
At that time? No, I'm talking about at the intro?
Oh, no, that's Daemon. Yeah, that's Daemon.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's Daemon's, like, black dragon armor.
There's a dragon at the end? I don't remember a dragon in the final battle. That's weird.
Yeah. So, Laenor.
Yeah. I know you're talking about.
Yeah, he's a dragon rider also.
Okay.
He was coming through.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Okay.
I was going to say, those were some good shots. Like, I'm surprised you don't remember that.
Yeah, I do.
The first one, he comes through and he, like, drags the claws and grabs all those guys. And the second time through, it's just, like, all that fire.
Yes. Yeah, I remember that now.
He, like, saves Daemon, too.
Yeah.
But, that's kind of the Triarchy strategy here. And so this little alliance between Daemon and the Velaryons and all their sellswords is not, they're losing the war. So the other two main themes of this episode are going to be, or the two main storylines are going to be Daemon, the Stepstones, and Rhaenyra at Prince Aegon's second birthday. I previously thought that Otto's brother was dead because I knew that he was a second son, and I thought the guy who swore fealty before was his dad. But that doesn't make sense because they're like relatively the same age. Yeah. And then we find out in this scene that guy is his brother. And the older brother, I would imagine, since he's head of house.
Yeah.
So they kind of conspire a little bit about putting Aegon ahead of Rhaenyra. And that's just, there's going to be so many scenes where they just talk about that. Where either Otto's trying to convince Alicent that she needs to convince Viserys to do it, or if it's
Rhaenyra, you know, making sure she's still, you know, the rightful heir, and Viserys, yeah, well, I mean, the whole time convincing everybody she is the heir, she is the heir, I'm not changing that.
Yeah. And then Otto,
and then in the next episode, all right, I changed my mind.
He tries like so many angles. It's like, even he tries the angle of marrying Rhaenyra to Aegon.
Yeah.
And so even in that way, like, Aegon would still be king and he could, like, you know, like, Rhaenyra would also be queen. So
we thought the last episode was horrible with the proposed marriage. This just stopped it right there.
Well, I told you this is more normal, like in the Targaryen world.
Right, yeah.
Like Aegon was married to both his sisters. And yeah. So this is like the show will probably never play it up that way, but like kind of in book lore, there's kind of thought to be like, you know, when she says that line in the show about how people say that we're closer to gods than men, they do have like a magical blood. Like there's a reason that, and George even talks about that, like there's a reason that over all these years, like there's never been any like horrible abnormalities and stuff, you know? I mean, there's a couple,
that's what I was gonna say.
there are a couple like kind of weird ones, but they're a rarity. Like most of them come out like this, you know, like it's not, yeah, it doesn't affect them in the way that it would other people. And it's something about like their dragon blood. Like it's hard to pinpoint all that stuff down because there was so much weird shit going on in like old Valyria before the Doom, like ridiculous amounts of blood magic stuff and sacrifice. And like, there's a bunch of just weird shit. So I don't think anybody really knows what's going on there exactly, but I also think that's kind of the way he wants it, you know, it to be like mysterious a little bit.
Right. Yeah. I get that.
So this was definitely like not, you know, while
George R. Martin, you sick man.
While super weird in our world, in Westeros with the Targaryens, this is more normal than him, you know, marrying like Lena Velaryon.
Yeah.
I do love the scene when they're at the little like pre-hunt feast. And everybody's trying to talk to him, or well, it's I can't remember which Lannister it is. It's one of the twins.
Is it Jason?
No, Jason's the other one.
Okay, I can't remember what this guy's name is then. Yeah. Isn't it just starts with a J too, doesn't it?
I don't know.
Yeah, but there's two. I mean, I know there's Jaime Lannister in Game of Thrones.
Yeah,
but Jason and Bob.
It's weird. I didn't really think about this. Bob Lannister, until just nice now. To meet you. I really think about this till just now when you brought up Jaime Lannister, but there's Jaime and Cersei are twins, and in Game of Thrones. And then in this one, we also have two Lannister twins, but that was the way he wrote it, like in the history at this time. It wasn't just like a choice the show made. And I don't think those are two separate actors. Like,
yeah, they're two separate people.
Yeah. And I don't think they're actually twins. Like, I'm pretty sure they're, I mean, they might be, but I've seen them both in like a lot of things. The guy who plays Jason Lannister, he plays a pretty big role through like three seasons of Vikings, I think.
Yeah.
But are you looking into that?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, but I like how the whole time everybody, like, he's trying to talk to him about the fighting in the Stepstones and like how bad it's going, and like, we really need to act now. He just keeps like moving to another place and like going over to get different kinds of food, and then he just asks somebody else like, where's Rhaenyra? And then like, he'll bring it up again, he just moves somewhere else and asks somebody like, where's Rhaenyra? So then Rhaenyra is in the Godswood and Alicent comes in. There's obviously still some weirdness there between them. Rhaenyra's pissed that Alicent married her dad. And then I wondered why there's been so many Nymeria references so far through the show. So do you remember that name from like a couple episodes ago? I'm pretty sure in the first episode, when she rips the page out of that book and gives it to Alicent.
Oh, yeah.
They're talking about Queen Nymeria and her 10,000 ships, which is like a really popular story within Westeros. And it's kind of long. I won't explain the whole thing to you, but the song that the bard is singing in the courtyard is also about Nymeria. And I kind of wondered if it's like a nod to, there was supposed to be a Nymeria show. That was one of the spinoffs they were going to do. but it got canceled, and it was one that everybody like always like really wanted to see. So I wonder if it's kind of been a little nod to that, you know. But also too, like to a up and coming queen, like a warrior queen, like Nymeria would be kind of a hero. What about those two dudes? What did you find out?
It's so. So, Jason Lannister and Sir Tywin Lannister?
Yeah.
Does that sound right?
Yeah.
Okay, it says it's played by the same person.
Jefferson Hall, guy?
Jefferson Hall as the twins, Lord Jason Lannister, the Lord of Castle Rock, and Sir Tywin Lannister.
That's weird.
Yeah.
It didn't, I mean, I guess maybe we've gotten to that point, man, where it just like looks so good that you can't tell, but
he was in Game of Thrones.
Who is he in Game of Thrones?
Sir Hugh of the Vale, just for two episodes.
Oh, yeah.
That's funny. Yeah, it says he plays both of them. But I think there was only like one quick scene where they talked to each other or whatever, and they're in the same room or whatever, you know. Dude, he was on...
there's a scene where they're sitting right next to each other, and it doesn't look weird at all.
Yeah.
Like, it looks like two actors sitting next to each other.
Well, think about, like, the CGI for the dragons, man. I mean, that's really good.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm sure they could easily do that. But he's in the full first season of... Taboo with Tom Hardy. I don't remember him though. Of course, it's been years since I've seen that show, but
yeah, I don't remember him either. That's weird. He's been in a lot of stuff. He's in Force Awakens, and then the 2018 Halloween. He's in Tenet.
He plays Tom Hardy's sister's husband in
Tenet. Oh my God, the crazy guy.
Yeah, the crazy dude.
God. That sucks. This guy's a good actor. Why is he so forgettable?
Sometimes that happens, man.
What the fuck? Okay.
Where's Rhaenyra? Where's Rhaenyra?
Okay, so Rhaenyra and Alicent in the Godswood, put ice cold bitch. Yeah, Rhaenyra is just like, she's pissed. You know, she's not happy with Alicent. Alicent's trying to kind of mend things, but Rhaenyra's not having it.
Right.
In the wheelhouse on the way to the hunt, we're just kind of reminded some more of Rhaenyra's duties. And later on, Viserys explains it in a way that I think finally makes more sense to her. Because I feel like the way he's been saying it is like, I don't know, how he explains it to her later is like, if you want to shore up your own claim, you know, like if you want to ensure your dynasty here, then you have to marry, because you're going to need kids who can follow in your line, who will be named king next, you know?
Right.
And because without that, then the line of succession like doesn't look good, you know?
Yep. Or dies either way.
Yeah. So he kind of explains it to her later in a way that makes more sense to her. But that's kind of what they're talking about here. She's going to be expected to marry, to kind of make alliances for them. At the camp, Rhaenyra talks with the ladies, just kind of like some of the ladies at the court who go along for these things.
The ladies and the gimp. Poor guy.
Yeah, and that's one of the Strongs. I think that's Harwin Strong's like youngest son. Um, Oh, so there's kind of a just a like we see that there's a debate back and forth between
The Stepstones, intervening in the Stepstones or not.
yeah, and kind of the concept of some people are like a lot of people are taking the stance of, well, Westeros isn't it at war, it's it's Daemon and the Sea Snake who are at
Right.
war. Like, well, no, we are at war. Like, even
Well,
though
and
they started it, like, this involves us too.
right. And there was a thing that was said earlier at the pre-feast,
Pre-feast.
about the pre-feast, pre-feast 2022, about, I think it was either Otto or maybe one of his other kind of council people kind of giving him some guidance on just like if we send ships now, it's going to make the throne look weak.
It was auto.
So I mean there's a lot of like strategic stuff to it. I mean you can't just be like, all right, well, here we go. We're gonna do it. I mean anytime you declare war, different stuff like that, there's always repercussions. Somebody's gonna get offended by it and they're not gonna like what you're doing. Or they're gonna call you a tyrant or whatever, and yeah. And then there's stuff like that where it's like, I gotta be strategic because I have to make sure that I still the throne still has power and we don't look weak and we're kind of like, oh well, yeah, we'll go ahead and help you,
Yeah.
But it's a hot topic.
Yeah. So then Jason Lannister comes and talks to Rhaenyra. They talk about Casterly Rock, and he lets on that that him and Viserys have been talking about a marriage pact possibly. And I put down Casterly Rock on here because that's just another important place I kind of wanted to talk about. Like he was saying, there's these big structures in Westeros, like the biggest ones on the continent, and the wall in the north is one of them. The High Tower in Old Town is another. And Casterly Rock is, they say, the biggest. There's like debate whether the wall is bigger or Casterly Rock is bigger, but it's modeled after the real world Rock of Gibraltar. Like, I don't know if you know anything about that,
I've heard that
but
name. I mean, I couldn't picture it. I'll look it up here.
it's been used by many armies over time as just a fortification. There's all these like tunnels and stuff that run through it. And yeah, I know it's kind of interesting, but Casterly Rock is kind of like that. The castle is at the top, but there's just like miles of caves and stuff that run below it. And there's like gold mines in there. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff. The Lannisters are a really wealthy and powerful house. So.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Dang Lannisters.
Just more of Viserys and Rhaenyra fighting, and this time kind of in full view of everybody in the court. There's like a super awkward scene where
What's
they
going on over
realize,
there?
yeah, everybody is watching them, and then Viserys just kind of like laughs it off. And then he turns back to Rhaenyra, just gone.
Oops.
They talk
That's
about
what
this.
she. Oh, go ahead.
Well, they talk about this stag, the White Hart, which is, yeah, I don't know why they were calling this one the White Hart. It's not white like the other one was.
The one that he ended up killing?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but that's what they said. They said it's not a white heart, but it'll do. You
Yeah.
don't remember them saying that?
I mean, I remember him saying like it's not white,
Yeah.
but yeah, I don't know. They're
Yeah.
calling it like the king of the forest, like a huge.
Well, and they talked about before, the dragons basically took over, this was the king of the forest, Yeah. I just kind of wonder if there's some symbolism between the scene where Viserys kills it. I mean, he has to stab it twice and it not being, you know, white. And then Rhaenyra and Sir Christian being approached by one. And you know, Sir Christian wanted to kill it. And Kristen. She told him not to. Kristen. Sir Kristen. Yeah, anyway, he wanted to kill it. She told him not to, and she let it go. So I was wondering if there was some type of like symbolism in those two scenes.
Yeah. I gotta imagine there is, because it's
too deep for me.
Well, in the first episode of Game of Thrones, there's a they find a dire wolf.
Yeah,
they find a dire wolf that tried to kill a stag, like a really big stag, and they both died, and the stag's antler was like through its chest, you know, like it had died that way.
Yeah.
Or through the neck or something. And then, but it was pregnant. So it had these like five puppies. I think five, six. they're like seven. Yeah, it had six puppies. And so they took them and they gave one to like each of the Stark kids.
Yes. I've actually seen that scene.
Okay. Yeah, that's a big foreshadowing scene in the show, because later it's like it's the stag that brings down the wolf. Like it's you could say that it's Robert that brings Ned down. You could say that it's Joffrey, even though he's really a Lannister, so it would be a lion.
Right.
Yeah, there's several ways you could look at it, but it is, you know, pretty big foreshadowing. So I imagine this will be too.
Yeah. I just wonder how.
Yeah. Rhaenyra rides away. She's followed by Kristen Cole. I did hate her super privileged, nobody knows what it's like little rant here. Because Kristen Cole like grew up pretty poor. Like, even though his dad was like a steward to you good?
Yeah, I'm good. Oh. I was hearing some noise. I was trying to figure out what that was.
Even though he grew up like a son of a steward and like a great house, he's still, you know, he's a commoner.
Right.
And so he tells her that, you know, a lot of people would just be happy to be in your place.
Yeah.
And yeah, then she gives him the, well, nobody knows what it's like to be me. It's like, yeah, I got to imagine the super poor people like barely eating like in Flea Bottom in King's Landing are probably, they probably would be happy to trade places with you.
Oh, easily. Well, and that's, I think he said that to her, didn't he? At one point,
yeah, he's, well, like, you he know, says
plenty
that
of people would trade.
And then, yeah, and then she comes back with a, well, none of them have had to be me. Like something right. like that. Like, what the fuck?
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My note for the next scene was, shit hands? What the fuck?
Wait, what happened?
So it's where they're out there tracking the deer, and then...
Oh yeah, yeah.
His like master of the hunt or whatever, like brings him the shit. And he's like, there's like less of yours. Bro, it's like even worse. Okay. So at first I was like, okay, like I know this is how they used to hunt, you know?
Right. Yeah. It is what it is.
But if I'm Viserys, I think I'm going to take this guy's word for it. Okay. I'm not going to test it myself. And I'm sure as fuck not going to take my glove off before I grab this shit. Why did he take the glove off?
Did he? I didn't think he did.
He took his glove off.
I don't remember him taking his glove off, because I remember because
he takes the glove off and then he takes it and like breaks it up.
Oh my God.
What the?
Are you sure, man? I don't remember.
I'm 100% positive. Okay,
because I was thinking he didn't take his glove off. He was just rubbing it like that and smelling it. And then later on, like, I mean, just a few steps later, somebody said something to him. He, like, put that same hand right on their shoulder.
I'm pretty
like,
sure. I'm pretty sure it was the opposite hand because I thought that also. I was watching what was going on with this very close.
Maybe it was. You were really into that, aren't you?
Like, I was so fascinated.
What is he doing?
Like, what is he doing?
Yeah, what is he doing?
No, you're king, man. You take this guy's word for it, and then you just kill it if you want to, if that's what you want to do. So then Jason and Viserys talk. Viserys is just getting more and more pissed. Like, as this hunt is going on, he's getting more and more drunk and he's getting more and more pissed.
More wine.
Yeah. Because everybody's just, it's like it never ends, you know? Somebody's always trying to talk to him about who Rhaenyra needs to marry, who, well, you know, if they're going to put Aegon on the throne instead of her. And he just wants to be out there and hunt, you know?
Right.
So
you're supposed to be my relaxing time.
Yeah.
And you're bringing up the stepstones and marriage and
it's like my kid's birthday.
Yeah. It's like, come on, guys. Come on, man.
Yeah. And he just kind of goes off on Jason Lannister a little bit there. We already talked about Otto's proposal. It's that Viserys should, what do they call it? Like betrothed, that he should, marry Aegon and Rhaenyra. Yeah. Viserys says that he hates politics, and then Harwin Strong coming back in with that sound advice again. Like, he knows that they need to bring House Valerian back in. He knows that
you were right. He did take his glove off.
He takes the glove off.
I don't, for some reason, I didn't think he did. Okay, it's his right hand. Hold on. He's way. He's going. You can go ahead and talk. This is a private secret.
The suspense is killing me.
The suspense is killing me. Oh, doo-doo hands. man. What advice did Strong give him?
That he should wed Rhaenyra to Laenor Velaryon, who's the oldest son of House Velaryon. He's actually a little bit older than Rhaenyra, I believe.
You think so?
I think so, or about her age.
Okay. Is he the same one, though, that was in episode one at the tournament? Or do they have three kids? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I will say he looks a little bit younger, like, at the tournament. He does.
Here's the thing about it. That's probably almost 3 years ago.
Oh yeah, I guess so.
Yeah. So that's why I was asking that too.
Yeah. Well, he's around her age, give or take a little bit. And yeah, that would honestly probably be a pretty good match. He's, like, by all accounts, a decent guy, you know, like, at this point.
Well, he advised him on the, you know, about Viserys marrying, was it Lena?
Yeah.
Is that her name? Yeah, Lena. And I think he's basically trying to give him the same advice of, was like, look, you can still kind of, you know, bridge the gap here between the two houses and make it strong. Because obviously after what happened with that in the last episode, you know, your ties are kind of, I don't want to say severed, but I mean, they're definitely damaged.
Yeah.
You know, I think he even says in this episode, about, like, you know, you can make it right, you know, basically.
Yeah. He says this will go a long way to fix any, like, slight, real or imagined, you know, so right. He basically, yeah. Rhaenyra is out with Kristen Cole still. She's kind of just been refusing to go back. They get attacked by a boar out there, and I'd like to give her the credit for the kill, but Kristen Cole really like brought it down. And then when it wasn't finished and started flopping around, Rhaenyra like stabbed it a bunch of times in the head. Viserys talks to Alysanne about the dream. Yeah, I think it's something that Viserys has kind of always struggled with. Like, there are people in their line who they call dreamers, but there are very few who have these like prophetic visions.
Right.
And yeah, he's had this dream. I think he only had it like one time.
Yeah, one time. Because he talked about he prayed every night that it would come back.
Yeah.
But
and it was a dream that a son would be born to him wearing Aegon the Conqueror's crown. And yeah, I think he's like struggling with that a lot because he doesn't know if the dream is a prophecy and he wants to put Rhaenyra on the throne, but he feels like he'd be going against that also. So he's just really conflicted. Right. Everybody's chirping in his ear constantly.
Right. And I think at the same time, he's wondering too, if it's just a dream and that's it, because he wants a son so badly all those years he wanted a son so badly to take his place, you know, never even thinking about Rhaenyra possibly being the heir because of Daemon at that time was the heir as kind of a backup, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah. So he's kind of wondering is it just my mind fabricating these dreams because I want a son so badly?
Yeah. Yeah, the stag death scene, kind of like you were talking about, there's a weird foreshadowing kind of feeling. Yeah, it takes him twice to kill it.
Like when he stabs it the first time, it's not dead. He's like, no, a little to the left, right about here.
Yeah.
I'm the king, man. I know how to kill a stag.
He's using the Lannister spear.
Yeah, that's right.
It's like, I don't know, there's a lot of weird elements to this that we'll have to kind of keep an eye on to see if they reprise later. Rhaenyra sees the white stag after that. And yeah, again, I don't, you know, on the surface, it looks like that's kind of the acknowledgement that she like is the heir, you know, that she's like the chosen one. It's like because I said before, you know, like getting this white stag will be it's like a good omen, you know?
Right. Yeah.
And then, yeah, she doesn't let Kristen Cole kill it. And then we just get a scene with like Rhaenyra riding back through the camp with the boar that she killed, and
the boar and the blood.
Yeah, she's just like covered in blood. Back in King's Landing, Otto pressures Alicent to get Viserys to name Aegon the heir. He just kind of tells her like how this is gonna be, you know. That
hold on, back up real quick. When she's riding into camp with the boar, there was a couple of people that kind of acknowledged her. Do you think that's kind of a little bit of a scene of showing there's some support out there for her?
Yeah, possibly.
I think it's just kind of like a tiny nod to it.
Yeah.
Because I think there's that. And then there's the whole thing with the Stepstones later of where it's like, you got to believe that they're going to support Daemon now. So I think throughout this series, especially this first season or whatever, you see a lot of back and forth of who's going to support who, you know, who wants who on the throne.
Yeah, because we will see, you know, during the dance, it's not like Rhaenyra is like, oh my god, what am I gonna do? Like, it's just us against the world, you know?
Right.
It's like, no, the dance really splits the realm.
Yeah.
There's people who, when they swore fealty to Rhaenyra in that room, they meant it, and they will die before they break it, you know?
Right.
I'm pretty sure the Starks included, like a lot of those older houses that have like a lot of honor, they're going to be the ones who stand with her because that was the king's wish, you know?
Right.
So then we're going to go back to the Stepstones, and that's where we're going to, well, so we go to the Stepstones. The letter comes that, I'm doing this backwards. Viserys tells Alicent about the letter, that comes from Draemon Velaryon.
Was it Draemon?
I think so. Or Dreha.
It's his brother. It's what's his name? The one that was
Vaemon with a V.
Okay, and that's whatchamacallit's brother, right?
Yes, it's
what is his name?
Corlys.
Corlys, yeah.
Yeah, it's Corlys' brother.
Yeah.
I believe his younger brother.
He looks younger.
And he sent a letter to King's Landing telling them the situation and asking for aid. Viserys does end up sending a letter in reply, but this one's to Daemon. Viserys tells Rhaenyra that she has to shore up her succession. This is when he like really puts it super bluntly for her, you know, like, yes, I've thought about, like, there were times when I thought about making Aegon heir, but like, you're my heir. I named you heir. And this is the things you're going to have to do for, in other people's minds, you to remain powerful, you know? Yeah. So he tells her too, he's not going to try to make a marriage pact for her, that she can search out somebody who will provide her some of the things she needs and that she also likes.
Right.
Which is huge. That's just like not done for like high lords and ladies, you know?
Right.
Like, your marriages are arranged and that's pretty much it.
Well, and they either, I think they said in this episode too, is like, your arranged marriages are strategic. It's for strength and power. You know, you marry one family, it's like you might get a bunch of ships and a bunch of armies, or you might get, you know, whatever. So it's all about strategy. Well, I kept wanting to say strategic, but I want to say strategy.
And then he also lets her know about that he's sending word and aid to Daemon. In the Stepstones, Daemon gets the letter and things just aren't going well. Like, no. Vaemon's trying to get a mutiny going, basically.
Well, I mean, they said it flat out. It's like the mercenaries are losing hope. Their foot soldiers are losing hope. Everybody's doubting Daemon, and there's definitely like a mutiny brewing, and Daemon knows it, I think.
Yeah.
For sure.
But it's like Viserys said, like, he'd rather die than like ask for help.
Yeah.
But Laenor has a plan. Like, we see that kind of right before the letter comes. He's got an idea. Which is cool. Like, just another, sometimes we see these in Game of Thrones, there's like these younger people that just have like a really good military mind. And sometimes it's just a fresh perspective, you know?
Right.
You know, you look at the world a different way, or you look at a battle a different way. And so you can see it from different angles when somebody might've only seen it from this side forever.
Right.
yeah, Robb Stark was a big one of those where it's like Tywin Lannister's armies, like Tywin Lannister had been in countless wars and couldn't beat a single battle against Robb, even though Robb was like 14 years old. Yeah, and I think it's just really like when he gets the letter, Daemon just kind of beat down, you know, like he just wants to prove himself to not only the realm, but I think more so to Viserys, you know.
Right.
Yeah, I think we just see that a lot with Daemon over the show because their parents died like early. And so I just think he has this need to kind of prove himself to Viserys. And I honestly kind of forgot about Laenor's plan, like right after this, when Daemon like just goes in there by himself, you know?
So was their plan to send him over there by himself kind of as a distraction?
Yeah, the plan was to send Daemon into
into the middle there
and kind of like gather their forces around him so that they could.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because see, that was one of my big problems too. I was like, come on, man. One on 1,000. Come on now.
Yeah.
Nice. And he, I mean, I understand like he gets, yeah, no,
nice,
right?
Nice old sleeper reference.
Well, I will say this too. I think it's kind of funny how we talked about O Sleeper the other day, especially with the first album, When I Am God, and watching House of the Dragon now. I don't know, for some reason, like I kind of connect those two, that album and like kind of like medieval battle. I don't know.
Yeah.
Cause like every time they brought out the archers, I always thought about We Are the Archers.
Yeah.
So
I can see that.
Yeah. But anyway, yeah, I just kind of was like, okay, come on. This is like Hollywood. Like, he's not going to die. He's going to take the whole army on himself. You know?
Yeah.
And it's not I thought he was just being crazy
at first.
Well, yeah, and there's that too. Maybe he's got a death wish.
Yeah.
Like you said, I'd rather die than ask for help. Then I'm going to go die.
Well, as quick as he like took the sword out and knelt down, I said out loud, I was like, there's no way he's about to give up Dark Sister.
There's
like
no way.
Plus, I know that like Dark Sister doesn't get lost because it ends up with Brendan Rivers down the road. So yeah, I just kind of like, then he just goes on his rampage. But I did really like the way all of this was shot. It made me think of Jon Snow, like out there in the middle of that fight with the Boltons, where it's like everybody's getting killed all around him and there's like arrows falling and like none of them are hitting him. You know, it's just like a chance game. So like you shoot like that many arrows up, you know, like there's, you might get hit, you might not.
Wait, is that in the Battle of the Bastards?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I must say, yeah, that sounded familiar.
Yeah.
Okay.
Where he'll be like fighting, and then it's just like a rain of arrows, and he like turns down and like all around him, you know?
Yeah.
And he's like moving as fast as he can. Like, I think he knows what he's doing, you know?
Yeah.
He knows he has to try to get to Crabfeeder as fast as possible, and he has to get as deep in there as he possibly can.
Right.
So, yeah, I liked it. He's just like, this is like Daemon at full strength here, just hacking through these guys, like running as fast as he can.
Yeah. I think the other problem that I had with it, that was the first one. The other problem that I had with it was I felt like I kind of honestly felt like it was going to be a lot longer than what it ended up being. Like the scene or whatever, the whole battle scene.
Okay.
I don't know.
Well, I mean, it's just, this is the final battle. You know, this is a war that's been going on for three years.
You kept asking me like for a couple of weeks, are you ready for the Battle of the Stepstones? Are you ready for the Battle of the Stepstones? It's like, oh, this is going to be big. Okay. It's going to be epic. The whole hour long show is going to be the whole battle. Okay. Awesome.
No.
Yeah, but then I think about like the Battle of the Bastards. Like, I mean, how long that took, you know?
That was most of an episode.
That was epic. Yeah.
So yeah, and a lot of that stuff was all done in like one shot, which I don't think this was.
No. I don't think so at all.
Yeah, I did think it was just kind of brutal, though. Like, Daemon's totally prepared to, like, there's a plan here, but he's totally prepared to just last stand this. He gets caught with a few arrows, and then, yeah, he's just in this moment where he thinks he's going to die. He's laying under that broken ship, and all those arrows are just, like, hitting the ship all around him.
Yeah.
And then as the Crabfeeder's men close in on him, he grabs Dark Sister, makes a last stand. And that's when...
Lainor?
Yeah, that's when Lainor and everybody comes in. Yeah. Well, I guess the army comes in first, and then... just as Daemon's about to square off with these guys, then Lainor hits him with the fire.
Comes in, yeah. Fireball.
I did like the music, too. The music through, like, from where Daemon, like, goes to surrender, like, all the way through there. It was really cool. Yeah, and then just, it's a pretty brutal fight. Like, they are just hacking their way through these guys. But the Valyrians are way better armored and weapons and stuff, yeah.
See, I don't think the other guys had any armor.
This is kind of a ragtag bunch.
Yeah. Literally, they had rags on. I was honestly just about to say, I think they just have rags on. He said ragtag. Yeah, that's it.
And then it's the most brutal scene in the episode where Daemon chases Crabfeeder into one of the caves and just comes back out dragging half of his body. Just cut all the way through him. It's that Valyrian steel. Disrespect,
man.
Just like super unsettling, though.
Yeah,
like you just got him by the hand and like dragging him like
come on,
back
buddy.
Onto the battlefield.
Well, you gotta have brutal proof.
Yeah,
I did it.
All right, that was it for this one.
Yeah,
I think the conflict's gonna ramp back up next week, a little closer to home.
Yeah, I think so.
Cool. We got any final thoughts on the episode or anything?
Nothing I can think of, man. I put my thoughts out there.
I liked this one.
It was good.
Yeah. I wish would have had maybe a little less of the stuff going on with the hunt. I don't know. Some of that just seemed kind of pointless.
Yeah. But... did you watch the trailer for the next episode?
Yeah.
What'd you think about the references, the Song of Ice and Fire again? All I could think of was you, man.
I'm over it. It doesn't,
oh, that's great.
Like, it just doesn't matter to the Dance of the Dragons. It doesn't matter with this story. And like, yeah, I guess you could say like, oh, it's what fuels Rhaenyra to want this or whatever. Like, it's her birthright. She was named. Like, that should be enough of her reason, you know? Like, I just feel like they don't bring any of this up in Fire and Blood, like, during this time. Maybe they do, but I don't think so. Yeah, I don't want to hear about it. I don't want to hear all the subtle Game of Thrones references in this show.
Well, we just want to make sure if people don't realize that this is a Game of Thrones show. It's related to Game of Thrones, and this is how. We're just going to throw some tidbits out there for you.
I do like, though, the guy in the background who was like, who will it be? the daughter,
yeah,
the brother, like, or the babe of two.
What in the world?
I don't know. I think it's a guy.
Join us next week on House of Dragon. Guy,
like, in the street.
Probably so.
Like, sometimes there's people out there, like, trying to cause dissent or, you know.
I just wanted to picture a guy in a sound booth. Love and tragedy, blood and guts.
Who will it be?
Find out next week on House of the Dragon.
Okay, cool. All right. Well, we will be back next week for episode 4. Until then, make sure you go over to YouTube if you're not already watching this there. And follow us at Is Survived By Productions, or you can just go and search the House of the Dragon podcast. We have several, well, not several. We have two other shows that you can check out in the meantime. The Red Right Hand podcast, which is a rewatch podcast of the Peaky Blinders, going all the way back to season 1 and watching it in real time in season 6. And then there's also a music podcast that we do called History of the Cores. You can find both those at Is Survived By Productions. Or you can just search those out on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, any of those. You can follow us on Twitter at Is Survived By Pro. That's where you can find out about our new episodes coming out and new shows we might be doing. And you can also follow me on my personal at Joshua Lynn Gary at Twitter. I think that's it.
Twitter.
All right. We'll see you guys next week.
See ya.